Well, I'm not going to even wait. I'm not going to even wait until all the bugs get worked out here. It's like Southwest Airline, you know. I mean, there's always some computer problem. And we don't have the light adjustments, etc. here, but that doesn't matter, right? Because the audio is what's important. I have some very, very drastic news to impart here. Positive, negative, super positive, all of that. Okay, so let's get right to it. There we go. Well, you see, it did pop up here. And so I can do a little adjustments on the fly here as we get into this. But don't wait for anything right now. Get into the groove, and immediately. So I asked the I asked for help. I asked for help. What is going on here, and what can we do? Let's see if I can. And immediately I got a response, and the response is was scary. And then I said, what can we do about it? And then that response was reassuring. So let's get to the reassuring part first. Welcome to the video. I don't know if you're a new viewer or not, but here we are talking about really the right to consider free will and how that extends to our situation, our experiencing. How does it really extend to our experiencing? Now, the Tibetan adepts, they realize it extended to everything, and including the bodies, and they ultimately just turn their bodies into light when they're ready to leave this world. They've done enough communicating, that's enough. Just turn their body into light. In other words, free will extends, they said, extends to everything. And we're not trapped at all. We're absolutely free. We are not trapped at all. Completely free. Many adepts from other traditions, the same. Tibetans may be the ones right now who have the most intense recent tradition of this realization. They're still Tibetans turning their bodies into light at the time of death. And so what we're focused here is on making sure that we have the right to pursue this question of free will and to ask whatever questions we want to about, do we have free will? How far does it extend? Does it extend to perception? Does it extend to the body? Does it extend to the world? Does it extend to life, existence? And we should have the right to follow these questions and find answers. Now, there is a very, very large push in the world, a most severe push, to crush any questions about free will and to say basically we don't have free will and it's solved, or to dictate to us what our how free will extends to us. There's a very powerful echelon that wants to control us all and to dictate to us how much freedom we have. And the idea of simply an open-minded inquiry into this, they want to crush it. So some of these folks tried to crush Tibet and the Tibetan spiritual culture, which they certainly did in Tibet. Fortunately, the Tibetans, many of them, were able to flee this in 1959 and have been able to do an amazing job at continuing their presentation of free will and investigating it. This is very helpful for the world, for the spiritual ecosystem of the world. The world has a physical ecosystem, you might say, right? Geophysical ecosystem. It also has a spiritual ecosystem, which is more important. In fact, the geophysical is just a reflection of the spiritual ecosystem. So our spiritual ecosystem is under much more threat than our physical geophysical ecosystem, which is under very severe duress as well. And so the Tibetans actually are a very important part of the spiritual ecosystem of the planet. Very important. So we don't ignore them. We most certainly do not ignore them. So my life has been totally wrapped around and completely involved with this issue of free will, investigating it, and supporting the right of everybody else to investigate it. And this is all important. You have to be able to clearly feel that you don't have some totalitarian system in place that's going to punish you for your thoughts and considerations and speaking up. This is what you see now, and maybe you can change later. And so there's a tolerance of freedom of ideas, which is what America stands for. And I've been able to do this in the United States of America, and so far nobody's bothered me. But that's about to change, actually. This is what I asked what's going to happen, and I was shown what's going to happen. So the bad news, we might say, is that there are going to be those who simply just disappear. The government's just going to have them disappear in the United States. Keep in mind, the United States is really a dictatorship now. And because of the 9/11 and all these new laws, ultimately the president was given power to have arrest anybody, secret arrest and secret detention, with no bypassing the legal system entirely. No writ of habeas corpus, which means you have to present the charges publicly in a court of public law, the charges against somebody and where they're being detained. The president, and only the president, now has the right to determine who they feel is a threat to national security, and to have them secretly arrested and detained, secretly detained, and nobody knows what happened to them at all. Well, this is no different than any sort of petty dictatorship, banana boat dictatorship, banana republic, banana republic dictatorship. Exactly what they do. They just have their opponents disappear. And the United States law is now written. It's unconstitutional, of course, but it's in place, so those who believe that they have the right to do that can exercise that right. At least they think they can. Now, most Americans disagree with this, absolutely disagree with it. But what I was shown today is that this is what's going to happen. This is what the pressure is that those who speak up for freedom, are likely just to secretly be detained and disappear, coming up very soon. In America, and nobody will even know about it, hardly. The families might say, "Well, what happened?" And she says, "Blank wall. You can't get anywhere with it. Can't get anywhere with it. Nobody knows." So I was like, "Wow." A lot of people are worried about this. That is for sure. Now, the folks that are behind this is a large conglomeration of ideologies kind of converging, where they feel free will. They don't really like it at all, because they want to be able to control the predictability of human behavior, our behavior here. We're not really humans, but we're spirit. But they want to be able to control the behavior of spirits pretending to be humans, so they can have a controlled society, which is a lot smoother for big corporations, for big politicians, for big bankers, for everybody. They want to be able to just to tell everybody, this is what you buy, this is what you do, this is where you live. It's called central planning. They want a massive central planning for the entire planet, like communist China, and they don't want anyone to be able to speak up against it at all. Now, this is nice for the fat cats and those in control, maybe. They think it's nice for them. Actually, it isn't, because they fail to inquire about free will themselves. And they promise everyone a material utopia. And that the production will skyrocket through the world, the distribution will be wonderful, and everybody's going to be happy in the world. This is what they say. But the issue of free will, nobody can even think about it. They say that's just a myth, and our job here in this world is to produce enough for everybody to be happy. Fix the environment, too. But they forget about fixing the spiritual environment, don't they? They absolutely do. Now, what to do about this hideous trouble that's coming up? And I said right away, I said, "Okay, thanks for indicating what's going to happen. Now, what is your response to this?" I was thinking, "Okay." And immediately the response was that the gurus are going to show up. They're going to show up in an understated way. You have to know what to look for. Okay. But they're going to show up. They're going to protect those whose passion is inquiry into free will, especially those who advocate this and teach this and know how free will does extend to everything, There's no fixation at all in our true identity and experiencing. Absolute free will. They're going to show up and protect. But it won't ride in a Rolls Royce in crowns and gowns and all this kind. No, it'll be understated. It'll be understated, but for those who know what to look for, they will be able to recognize them and say, ah, okay, I know what this is. This is a guru. This is a protector of free of our investigation inquiry, a Dharma king, a Dharma protector, which is really the importance of investigating this question of freedom, of free will. And where does it extend to? How far does it extend? Is there an end? Is there some limit to its extension? And all these questions that we have a right to ask. Okay, so they protect the right to ask those questions. Now, I said, well, what are we going to do? Well, we're going to sit on the sidelines of all the action in the world. Really, all the action in the world is just like a merry-go-round. People on their painted horses going up and down, life and birth, life and birth, life and birth. And they're just going on a merry-go-round, going around and around and around. And they don't get anywhere. So the idea of like somehow we're going to be left behind because we're on the sidelines is ridiculous. It's like somebody, parents sitting in a park and watching their children go round and round a merry-go-round. Are the parents saying, oh, we're being left behind, the children are journeying somewhere. Oh, well, no, that's stupid, right? And so there is no leaving behind. However, sitting on the sideline is the most difficult thing to do in this world, or any world, I would say. As all this massive so-called progress is taking place, we think, oh, we're really being left behind in the dust of history. It's not true. So the answer is to sit on the sidelines. And ultimately, everyone has to do this. Sit on the sidelines of existence and focus on realizing our free will. And then we realize there are no sidelines. There's no history. There's no story at all being told. We're absolutely free in 360 degreeness, all directions, so to speak. But sitting on the sideline is very difficult. So in order to sit on the sidelines without panicking, you have to practice, understanding, recognizing, accepting why you're sitting on the sidelines. You cannot just sit on the sidelines and not practice. It's not possible. You will suddenly be gripped with a panic and think, I'm getting left behind. And then throw yourself back into the mainstream, the tornado, really. It's just a tornado, you know. We think a lot of stuff's happening. But I can promise you this, that there's a perfect explanation for why we sit on the sidelines. And the Dharma kings are able to give this explanation very clearly. I've heard it from them. I've seen what they're pointing to. I've experienced it directly, so I know they're right. So we will get more than adequate explanation of why we're sitting on the sidelines. And I promise everyone that this is so. This is so. And we will get excellent practices to help us with this. But we have to practice. You can't just take it easy on the sidelines. Otherwise, you're going to start panicking, thinking that you're not getting with it. You know, wow. So, this is it in a nutshell, what's going on. So, the gurus will help us sit on the sidelines. This is what they've promised. Again, but this is you have to be dedicated to understanding why. I've spent my whole life on the sidelines, and I can tell you it's very difficult. But I've spent my whole life also on understanding why. Why do we do this? The world is much ado about nothing, actually. It's like building a bridge to nowhere. So you see all these people frantically building a bridge, except it's a bridge to nowhere. So who's being left behind? They say, you think, oh, no, once they build a bridge, they'll be able to go across the bridge and they'll leave me completely behind. No, they're building a bridge to nowhere, to nothing. It's just an absurdity. This world, those of us here in this world, you have to understand that this whole world represents an absurdity beyond a million times more than the most absurd French farce possible. You know, it's almost immeasurably absurd what we're trying to do here. We're trying to see how far we can take absurdity, really. And so we've taken it really far. But ultimately, mental chaos as far as we can take it, and that's no fun at all. So it's very absurd, this realm. And it's kind of difficult to see through that, but the explanations will enable us to see through this. No doubt about it. I'm convinced of this. I trust in it. I have confidence in this. And I exhort everyone else to have this inner faith and confidence that the explanation is there. Okay. Now, we may not always have it in our fingertips constantly right now because so much stuff is happening, but it is there. I have experienced it myself. Very clear explanation. And then after all, we get a little fuzzy about it. That doesn't mean it's gone away. It's like the clouds come over. That doesn't mean the sun has gone away. When the clouds part, the sun is very clear. Very, very clear. So an amazing day for me today. It's so much, and probably for you as well, right? Suddenly, I had been praying. I said, I want to be somewhere at a certain time. And it didn't look like it was going to happen at all. And we were down to like the last minute or hour or something. And I was just said, I basically said this morning, forget it. It doesn't look like it's going to happen. And no capacity, no money to do it, nothing. And then suddenly out of the blue, I just mentioned this to someone, family member really. And they said, hey, you know, you should do that. And they made it possible to do it. And so we're going to do it. And so I am going to be in the right place at the right time, where I knew I was supposed to be there on the sidelines, experiencing being on the sidelines at this crucial moment in history. Done deal. Done deal. It's so extraordinary. It's like your one of your greatest prayers suddenly just came true. I knew it was super important to do this, and I felt like for sure it's not going to happen. And at the last minute, suddenly it happened. So I'm almost, you know, speechless. It's just, but I try to take everything in stride. And now I have to really focus on this. Where we are in the 28th, 29th, 30th, 31st, the end of July is very important. Because this is when this push is going to really take hold very strongly in terms of free will and your question. Do you want to continue to question it, or are you just going to settle for materialism and say, I don't really need to keep pushing it. Why, you know, it's enough. Well, with that attitude, you'll end up with no inquiry into it at all very soon, actually. And those who do want you to inquire, they may disappear if they don't accept protection from the gurus. They may very well disappear, and the society will just seem like, oh, it's just bland materialistic utopia, and we just watch trivia shows and we just think, oh yeah, I got nice food and everything's fine, and that's it. What happens is, though, the vague mental troubles start to begin to surface in all sorts of bizarre ways, and your personality suddenly takes on aberrations, and you feel disoriented, and all sorts of mental problems arise, actually. And they say, what happened to my utopia? And it turns into a dystopia. So this is the picture, and right on cue, I had prayed and prayed for a long time. I said, I need to be somewhere at this time, but I don't know how to make it happen at all. I just didn't give up faith. I said, you know what? The guru's going to do it for me. So I didn't give up faith in the gurus. I asked Jamyang Khyentse Choki Lodo, our bus driver, my bus driver, certainly. I said, if you can make it happen, make it happen. And he did. He did. He's making a lot of things happen right now, as a matter of fact. He's very understated. It's like a car that's like really good, but no, most people don't really know that. It's kind of, the styling is kind of just like, you know, not too sporty. It doesn't look too fast or too sporty or too luxurious or anything, but it's really luxurious, it's really sporty, and it's really fast, but it doesn't appear that way as far as its styling goes and its marketing and all that kind of stuff. It's just very low-key marketing. There's some cars like that, actually. I know one of them, at least. It's like that kind of car shows up in your life, and you know, people look at it and say, oh, yeah, no big deal. They're looking at their attention's elsewhere. It's like a muscle car that doesn't look like a muscle car, something like that. Speaking of that, again, I did another intense workout. Very intense. Wow. I just keep doing it. I just keep doing it. Weight was pretty good this morning. It's getting down there. It's going down. So I'm going to try to make my weight by the 24th, which is just 2 days away now. Pretty much I have just the 23rd left to make my weight. So I got 1 day left to, you know, maybe drop a pound or so, something. I don't know. We'll see. But man. So, and also today it was brought home very, very clearly. This is what's called the turnover times. And this is when however you interpret that turnover times, is this the time that we turn the country over to what? To communism? Very likely. Communism is just the ideology that free will is a myth and that humanity is better served to completely forget any such notion that we're humans, we're here, we die, this is our home, there's no afterlife, and we're stuck, there's nothing we can do at all, and central planning is the best way to go about our lives, and this is the only way to be happy. We have to be happy with the flesh. The flesh gives us happiness, nothing else does. The spirit's a myth, all this kind of stuff. This is called communism. It's extremely atheistic, and it's designed to try to design a perfect society, which in order to do that, they have to get rid of the notion of free will, which is why they dislike Tibet so much and treated Tibet in such an abhorrent fashion. Get rid of free will. They can't stand it. They said, this, we can't have a utopia with this. You know, let's get rid of it. They don't like the Dalai Lama flying around and, you know, empowering all these Tibetan settlements everywhere. Right? They could say, oh, it's political, blah. No, no, they don't. They hate free will. Communists hate free will. It's to them, it's their adversary, that what they want to get rid of. President of the United States is a communist, plain and simple. You know, a lot of intelligent people know that. I mean, you know, you could tell he is, most definitely is. He doesn't love free will at all. If he could, he would crush it. He would absolutely crush it because he thinks he knows better than everyone else, and he knows how to dictate your life. He says, if I just dictate your life, you'll all be much happier than you are now. That's his attitude, actually. And people like him, power-hungry people like him, this is their attitude. They think they know better than you what you can do with your life, and that if they were a dictator over you and could dictate your life, you would be, you know, happy. Okay? And they, you know, these people have every intention of doing so, of dictating your life to you. And they have plans to do so. And this is communism. Communism believes in central planning, that your life is dictated to you, what you do from cradle to grave, and this is the best way to have experienced human happiness. This is what they believe. And so they cannot tolerate a free society where people have free will to consider, well, maybe I just want to sit here by a lake for 10 years in a little cabin or something and really dig into what is life really? What is my mind really? What do these dreams really mean? What do these great spiritual teachers really mean? Well, the communists want to get rid of all those great spiritual teachers and tradition. They want to wipe it out. So nobody even, they say that's all a myth. Bunch of radicals back then who were just wasting everybody's time, and nobody was happy back then anyway. So it's not even worth looking at. They destroyed all these great statues and icons, like the Padmasambhava statue, which is the central icon of Tibet. We have pictures of it, fortunately, and I highlighted on my Facebook page, Zogchenpa for President. I put that Facebook page up. It's up now. Facebook.com/Zogchenpa, DZOGCHENPA, FOR, President. Zogchenpa for President. So I put the picture of Padmasambhava to represent Zogchenpa. Now, Zogchenpa is actually formless. And what is Zogchenpa? It's the true nature of mind. It's formless. It's absolutely free, cannot be defined, and absolutely formless. That's Zogchenpa. And Padmasambhava, the statue, is a great representation, maybe the best I've ever come across for this formlessness, because I can feel this intense formlessness there. The utter sky-like nature of mind. See, the body just seems to be this very superficial little, cheap little mask. Behind it is this absolute sky-like nature of mind, completely formless. It's just, wow. It is so intense. It's just beautiful, that statue. And the communists destroyed that, along with all the treasures and iconographic items that they could find. They destroyed it. They destroyed them. They razed the monasteries, a couple thousand, more like several thousand, destroyed the books, destroyed everything they could. And then, of course, they're very focused on public relations. They keep a couple of touristy monasteries open and show people, oh yeah, the Portala Palace is still fine, you know, the Sambye Monastery is still fine, this one's still, the famous ones, where tourists go. Okay. But the number of monasteries they destroyed across all of Tibet is an extreme number. And they allow a few of them to be rebuilt as long as they can control who's there and what's being taught, etc., etc., etc. And so don't be fooled by the superficial public relations of having touristy stuff. Almost like, oh yeah, everything's so fine. Isn't that nice? You have this wax museum or something, and have these statues of these old Tibetan gurus and lamas and stuff. Oh yeah, and the pretty decorations are still there, and the prayer flags. Oh, everything is fine. Not so. Not so. I got a report back from friends who went to Tibet, and it's extremely oppressive there, actually. So this is what communists do. They don't want you considering free will at all. They do not. Plain and simple. So this is a dividing line. Do we have freedom to consider free will? Or do we want someone to dictate to us how our will is exercised, and thinking that this is the way to happiness? So there's division in the world over that. Free will seems to be a difficult path. Communism seems to be an easy path. And sometimes when you take the easy way out, it's not so great. Now, the gurus are giving every indication right now that they are going to show up. Every indication. The post I did on Sri Sri Anandamayama devotee page, I can't remember the exact name of the Facebook page, it's still getting likes. It's like 200, and, I don't know, close to 250 likes and so many responses. And people are saying, that's what I needed to hear. I really needed to hear that. Which means people are desperate. They really need to hear the gurus are coming back. And they are. They are. They absolutely are. A picture was posted on my Facebook page from one of my friends this morning. The first picture I saw, it was a picture of Sri Sri Anandamayama, and it was the very first picture I ever saw of her. It was the very first time I came across her likeness in the world. I was aware of her spiritually in my mind, but I didn't know what her likeness actually looked like during her incarnation here. I've always been aware of her, but this is the first time I saw a picture of her. And the exact same picture was posted now, 19 years later, on Facebook this morning, and the quote was, you should practice as if God is very close to you. You're very, very close, in a very close connection with God. This is the way, she said, you should practice. And when you practice this way, she said, it's going to happen. Well, I've practiced this way my whole life. So what this picture and the quote indicated to me was, this, she's saying, this practice will bear fruit, and it's going to bear fruit right now. Because the first seeing of her picture caused a complete revolution in my mind, actually. Astonishing change in my life. Irreversibly changed. That very day, October 27th, 1997, I remember it very well. And it was like it was yesterday. I was going, I got all upset because all this New Age music, nobody's listening to my music. And they're all into this New Age music. I said, what? I finally got so upset. I said, I was doing all this efforts in music. And I said, let me find out. I didn't even know what this New Age music was really about. So I didn't listen to it. I heard some of it, but I said, what was it really about? And so I vowed to go to this New Age store that had all these CDs of New Age music. I said, I'm going to go there and listen to this stuff. They have listening stations. And I'm going to search among all this and find out, listen to all this stuff and get an idea. You know, why are people so into this stuff? Because they really were back then, 1997. So I walked into this store and went to the CD section. I'm browsing. And then there's a CD, a very unusual CD. It didn't look like the other ones. And it kind of had an orange border. And then had this picture of this woman there with all these flowers draped around her neck. It was a black and white picture. And this expression on her face that was so different. When I saw that, I kind of said, wow, what? That's odd. Then I kind of browsed some more, and then I looked at it again, and I browsed some more, I looked at it again. I said, I just got to see, what is this CD? This is just something very different. I got this feeling. So I looked at it, and in the back it said, Kirtan of Sri Sri Anandamayi Sankirtana. I said, wow. Then I put it down, and then I left the area. I said, huh. My mind was kind of like going in, around, like something was really starting to buzz in my mind. Then I went over the video section. I was browsing Vizio. I said, maybe forget the New Age music. Let me look at a video. I was just checking videos. And then I saw this video, and I saw this picture of this lady. And I said, huh, that's very interesting. I wonder who that is. Caught my eye. And I looked at it, and it said, Sri Sri Anandamayi Ma, a video of the life of this someone, life of this the autobiography of Anandamayi Ma or something. And I said, huh, very, very, I don't know what to make of this. I don't know who this is. What is going, never heard of her. I put that down. Then I wandered off into the book section. And this book caught my attention. This is Lives of the Goddesses or something. I said, huh, Lives of the Goddesses. I wonder what this is about. And I opened it up, and then and I looked at a section, and this, I opened it up, and there's this picture of this lady. And I said, this woman, I said, huh, that's a very interesting picture there. And it had this title, The Divine Life of Anandamayi Ma or something. But I didn't correlate any of this. I just said, this is, I just having these experiences in the bookstore. At the time, I didn't correlate that it was the same person at all. I just said, wow, this is really amazing what's happening here. And at some point, as I was wandering around the bookstore, I suddenly realized, this is all the same woman. All three of these different experiences I had independently of one another, not under realizing it was the same woman, they're all of the same woman. And at that point, the bells started going off. And I said, wow, something's going on here. I got to investigate this. So I got the video and I took it home. It was a, what do they call it, VHS or something, or VCR, VCR. VCR, I think, video cassette recorder, yeah, VCR and VHS format. Got home that evening, put on the video, and I'm sitting there, and it comes on the monitor there they have in my room, and I'm watching it, and right away it shows, it starts with her walking out of some temple, walking across the grounds with people following her. And immediately I was struck like by lightning. And I was just completely stunned into some sort of different mental viewpoint. And I began, tears just started streaming down my face, and I was just speechless. And I was just astonished by what I was seeing. And I watched the video, and I was just absolutely like my psyche just sort of just imploded or something. I was just in tears, just sobbing in tears. I couldn't stop. And it completely changed my life just like that. And at that moment, I said, I have to know everything there is to know about who this is. Because I saw right away that this was like someone who was in the same super grace as Jesus Christ. There's no question about it. It's like Jesus Christ walking in the world. It was just, I could tell, this isn't just like grace. This is super grace. In grace, we think of like, God grace be with a child, God grace be with a job, God grace me by not getting in an accident. I'm graced with this. I got this, went my way. This is wonderful. And we feel the grace of God is moving in the world this way and that way, etc. So we feel that's grace of God, and that's an aspect of it, sure. But this was something like so much more potent than that. I call it super grace. And I was just completely astonished by what I saw. Somehow my spiritual eye must have been seeing it. It was just my spirit was astonished by this woman, Sri Sri Anandamayi Ma. And I'm still astonished. It just never gone away. It's just, she's still absolutely astonishing. And there's nothing more you can say. The super grace is just beyond what anything we can really say. These are the Dharma kings. They bring super grace to the world, like a Jesus Christ. He brought super grace to the world. Very different story than the ordinary grace that we're used to, right? Now, so this super grace, as it expresses itself and it is as it appears in this world, occasionally it appears in this world. Well, this super grace, taking Sri Sri Anandamayi Ma as an example, in hindsight now, where we're at right now, and we're in a very precarious position right now, the right to inquire into free will, most people have given up on it, actually. They're too scared. They're too scared. They've been intimidated. There's an extreme intimidation program that's been going on for a long time. And most of us are simply too intimidated to even express and inquire, and we're scared of what we might find out. So most have been bullied into silence now and intimidated severely. Now, this super grace was entirely aware that this is what's coming in the world. So what it did was it appeared here in this world before all of this happened, before it got really severe, and gave us an opportunity to have like a 100 years really of experiencing this super grace to get used to it. So in 1916, okay, in 1916, Anandamayi Ma was what? She was 20 years old, okay, born in 1896. So she was 1916. 100 years ago, she was 20 years old. Okay? Starting her 21st year, you might say. She'd finished 20 years and starting her 21st year. And so we've had 100, and that's adulthood, right? So we've had 100 years to get used to her adult presence here in the world. 100 years. Think about that for a moment. That's a pretty long time, isn't it? 100 years. Pretty astonishing, right? To put that in the context. So we have been considering her for 100 years. I've been considering her for 60 because I've been aware of her since I was born. I was aware of this presence of super grace in the world. I knew there was super grace in the world. I didn't know who it was or what their name was, but I certainly very much aware of it, that there was super graces in the world in some way, and I knew it was a woman. But I didn't really know who it was till 1987, actually. Then I immediately said, "Oh wow, this is it. This is who." But unfortunately, she was already gone. When I found that out, I was really upset. So what the heck are we going to do? And she said, "Don't worry. Don't worry. You'll see me again. Don't worry. I've not left." So she reassured me that she just continued to get used to super grace. Now, super grace in any form is super grace. So it doesn't matter so much what form you're getting used to it in. It's that the importance is getting used to super grace. That's what's all important, because super grace attracts you like a great magnet to inquiry. Okay, as Ramana Maharshi said, our purpose here is inquiry, and he's absolutely correct. This is truly our purpose: inquire into what our free will. Are we really bound, okay, by an image? Are we really bound by the flesh? Are we really bound by the body and the world and all this? Ramana gives us extraordinarily clear answers to all of this. Super grace as well, Ram Maharshi, super grace. But he was not here when I was born. He passed away in 1950. I was born in 1956, where Sri Sri Anandamayi Ma was very much here in 1956. She had what, 26 more years to live, I think. 56, 66, 76, that's 20 and 82. That's 26 more years. So she was here 26 years of my life in here. She was here on this planet. So I have this very strong feeling that someone was here, in some super grace was here. So I was so distraught that she was passed away when I found out she passed away in 1982. I said, "Wow, I missed you by 15 years. That's horrible." But she reassured me. She said, "Don't worry. You'll see me again. You'll see me again. Just work to get prepared for that." I said, "Wow." Now, when you'll see me again, what does that mean? It means you'll see super grace again in this world. It doesn't mean her actual physical body presence looking exactly like her or anything like that. It doesn't necessarily mean that at all. It means you will come across super grace in this world again. And that is me, because I'm not really this body at all. Never identify with her body at all. That's super grace. Super grace doesn't identify with the body at all. Like Sri Ramana Maharshi, did not identify with the body at all. Absolutely not. They know we're not the body. We're not fixated at all. What we are is entirely free. We have perfect free will. So she promised me, this is the feeling I got, that you will see me again. So just prepare. And then I was shown what time frame to expect this to happen. And now I got this indication today that we're now right at those days. And we're counting days now. This is how close we are to super grace making its appearance in this world. And it's going to be understated. Now, let's get into this more clearly here. Okay, if you can stick with this, I pray that you can. And we take this in stride. We're very relaxed, humorous, and calm about it. This is the style I appreciate. I appreciate other styles, but for me, this is sort of the style that I'm most attracted to, you might say. We take it in stride. Matter of fact, we have confidence here. And let's just relax a little bit here. My mind is reeling a little bit, so full stop on the wow. Okay, now, Jesus said that he would return. What is Jesus? Super grace. Super grace. He returned at the end of the age. He indicated he's already back April 29th, 2015. He stated he is back. I heard him in a dream, addressed the world. He addressed the entire world, everyone here, said unequivocally, "I am back. I am here to relate with all of you as friends." And that's all he said. So, it's very important to look at this, as I did today, and had a great insight about all this. Now, we are all quite confused. We are all sinners, as you might say. We have all these regrets. We don't feel like we're perfect by any means. And we think maybe I'm fixated in some way and I don't really love freedom that much. I'm kind of scared. Continuity fear makes fools out of us all. So we're all kind of maniacs and fools here. This is the truth. Now, there's been a very diabolical twist to distort what Jesus is about in the world by the ego, by those who don't want us to investigate free will. And they say, we'll tell you what free will is all about. We'll decide how much free will you have, and we'll dictate to you. Organized religion can often be this way. And what they told was a big, big lie. Okay, a huge lie. And they said Jesus' purpose is to come to judge us. And that those who had accepted Jesus as their Savior, his vicarious sacrifice for our sins that paid the price to a wrathful God for our sins, that they would be saved. No harm would come to them. But those who didn't trust Jesus, when Jesus came back, his purpose would be to slay them and cast them down into eternal hell, of eternal flame, where they'll be burned, incinerated forever, and then extinguished. You know, in other words, a hideous, hideous fate befalls anyone who has not been accepted Jesus as their Savior. This is what they told the world. This is about as bad a message as you could possibly have told the world and to buy into this. Why? Why? Because you will be extremely frightened for Jesus to come back to this world, and you will deny that he's come back to this world. You'll say, oh yeah, I really want Jesus to come back, but he's not here yet. The very fact that he's already back and that very few have accepted this is a sign of how terrible this message has been throughout the ages. Because why? Because we're all still sinners, right? We haven't all repented to the extent where we've accepted our free will. We're still binding ourselves to delusion and arrogance, right? I'm not completely free of continuity fear, so I'm still messed up. And we all are, really, right? And so if we believe Jesus came to judge us, then every single one of us on this planet believes that Jesus is going to condemn us and cast us into eternal hellfire, and we'll be in God will annihilate us. So do any of us really want Jesus to come back yet? And the answer is no. We're way too scared because they're not quite yet, Jesus. I still got some issues, and I know you're going to judge me very harshly because I know you. We got to be perfect, you know, when you come back. Otherwise, you know, and so, or at least perfectly surrendered to you. And who's perfectly surrendered? No, maybe nobody. So what happens is this causes us to believe that Jesus has never yet come back. Not yet. Not yet. Not yet. They pray, come back, Jesus, Maranatha, Maranatha, Natha, but not quite yet, the next year, Jesus, you're like that. Well, I got news for you. He's already back. And I've been posting on Facebook, this page, you know, Facebook page, I think the Great Good News of Jesus, I can't remember the name of it, but it's on my main Facebook page. You can see on the you know, the side pages. I said Jesus Christ has already returned. I don't know if there's anybody else in the world that's actually clearly saying that. Exact April 29th, he returned, and I say what his proclamation is. He says, "I am back, and I've come here to relate with you as friends, and that is it. I've come back to relate with you as friends, and there's nothing that Jesus is about other than simply being our friend." There is zero judgment in Jesus Christ upon any of us. Zero. Never has been. So this notion that Jesus is coming back to slaughter the bad people and, you know, burn them with hellfire and they're going to be extinguished is complete nonsense. Never, ever, ever has Jesus Christ actually expressed this. This is a complete lie and distortion about him. He is only our friend. He is a perfect friend, a absolute perfect friend. And he is completely loving and kind and forgiving, just this perfect friend. And that's all he is. And that's all that he wants is simply to be our friend. He condemns no one. He condemns no one. His offer of friendship is to everyone, and that never ends because we never end. We're all eternal life. We're pretending to be otherwise in our arrogance, but we are all eternal life. And so Jesus simply extends the olive branch of friendship. He says, I'm just here to relate with you as a friend. And that's all he said. He did not say one word about anything else. That means this is all that he's about. He's our friend. Thank you, Jesus, for being my friend. This is real Christianity. There's no condemnation or judgment of anybody in true Christianity. It's simply the offer of friendship of spirit to spirit. The one life which we all are. There's only one life. We're pretending there's many little lives all separate. This is not true. There's just one mind, one life. But it's perfectly free. And so its expressions seem to take on all this unique creativity, but it's all being experienced by the one mind, actually. It's beyond our imagination to quite to experience this, but this is true. So guess what? Most people in the world are still waiting for Jesus, thinking that he hasn't come back yet. But he gave us 15 months to consider this offer of friendship. So we know that he's here. So we can get ready for this. It's just simple friendship. That's all it is. So this is why Jesus will be under the super grace, you might say, will be under the radar for a lot of people. They're looking for someone on a white horse with a sword. maybe with the warrior goddess Virgin Mary and Saint James riding, you know, right and left, flanked by them with their fiery swords, ready to cut down the wicked, and fill the streets with their blood and slay everyone that doesn't accept Jesus, and then so the world will then can be happy because everybody, you know, accepts Jesus, and then we have utopia here or something. Okay, they're waiting for that. But no, in comes Jesus in just this calm, friendly way. Or in comes super grace. Now, we don't put any limits on super grace as to how it appears. It can be one appearance, it can be multiple appearances, it can be no appearance. Yet the presence, somehow it's acting on our behalf. Keep in mind, Jesus was able to resurrect from the dead and appear. Do we not think that Jesus can make a body appear whenever he wants to? Of course he can. He doesn't need to go through any birth at all. He was showing you, I don't need to go through birth anymore. I can raise a body from the grave that's rotting in the grave, and I can raise that up and animate that perfectly. I don't have to be born as an infant in this world anymore. I can just appear anytime I want to appear here. It's true of all the saints. They can simply appear here, understanding they have the absolute free will to do so. There's no such thing as process at all. This is all just a mental projection of light. Light appears a body, boom, a body appears. Light disappear into light, a body into light, boom. Body disappears into light. So, now, those who have chosen to sit on the sidelines, they need to get after their practicing. This is a serious choice to make. And so we need to start getting support for our decision to sit on the sidelines as the world goes through this effort to destroy free will, the belief in free will. That's all they're doing, is trying to destroy free will, our belief in it, and divert us from it into a belief system that believes that it never existed. It was all just this crazy dream of people who were like psychotic or something, that they didn't have enough food and things, so they were craving for substitutes for that. Materialism says that our true happiness comes through things, getting, you know, the right stuff we want, the right tile pattern. And that the reason why we made up God, they think we made up God, is because of our deprivation of beautiful things. So they said that God's just a myth that we made up to try to to soothe our feeling of deprivation, that one day, God, you'll give us that nice tile pattern, nice bathroom. I know you will, but you know I don't have it yet, so I'm just keeping faith in you that you'll do it for me eventually. And now that we can all have any tile pattern we want, you know, we realize, oh, that was just sort of we made God up to try, like a security blanket, to kind of soothe our frustrations, but there's really no God at all. You know, that was just something we made up in our imagination to kind of calm our frustrations. This is what materialists believe. They absolutely believe this, that God's just, we just made it up. You know, fairy tales in the sky to make us feel better, that give us hope that one day we'll live in a palace also, you know, with these poor peasants that made up this religion because we really wanted to live in that luxurious palace, but we couldn't. But now everybody can have a Taj Mahal. And so there's no need for God at all. You realize that was just something we made up to soothe our frustrations and make an excuse for it. Like, well, maybe you're a sinner because you don't deserve the palace. You know, that's why you're not there. But now we can all have the right tile patterns we want. No need for God. And most people in the world are going along with this nonsense, okay? And this is what they want. This is what communists want. And that, you know, that's part of, you know, big corporations. That's what they want, of course. They want you to believe that your purpose is to make the right shopping choices. And of course, they'll tell you what those are. So we know what the right shopping choice is, and it's this. And everyone they want everyone to say, oh, thank you, dear mother, you know, and now we know how to be happy, and we're all very happy now because you gave us the right choice of the right, our right tile pattern, the right feng shui. Okay. So, again, those who believe in this, or the wrathful Jesus coming to judge us and slay the wicked, they're not ever going to admit that Jesus is back. they're going to miss the boat entirely. He's already back. He's been back for almost 15 months now. And again, he's not pressing himself on anybody. He's just, I'm giving you time to adjust to this offer of friendship, which I've been frantically working on. And moving towards, in the dream I had, I was the one that accepted it first and foremost, and there were some others that were leaning in that direction too. They wouldn't really want to go first. They thought, I don't know if I can trust this or not. And I said, well, Jesus, I can't have you be shut out here. You know, that's just so shameful for this planet. It's too shameful for words. I cannot bear the shame of that. So I will go ahead. And I was shaking in my boots, believe me. I was shaking and trembling. And then what happened was we both got down on the ground face to face. I tried to lower myself down to him like he was superior, and he wouldn't have it. So I finally prostrated myself on the ground towards him, and he prostrated himself on the ground towards me. So we were like face to face on the ground talking. That's how we had our conversation. We were both lying prone on the ground facing one another. Because he wouldn't let me get lower. He said, no, 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 no. I came back as a friend, and I mean it. Friends are equals. I treat you as an equal. That's how he tried to treat his apostles. He said, look, from now on, you know, we're friends. And I've imparted everything I can to you. So we had a conversation lying prone on the ground face to face. I don't remember what was said. I was just like, wow. He said a lot. We had a conversation. He said a lot. And so at some level, I know what he said. I just, you know, I don't recall exactly. But he was very happy. He was super willing and happy to have this conversation with me. So I've been through a lot of experiences that really, really had me shaking in my boots, trembling. Just my nerves were just about going to pieces. You know, it was so intense. It's just, I don't know what's going to happen. That's fine. There's no problem at all. We just had a friendly chat like friends would chat about, you know, that's all. Maybe we covered some areas of mutual interest or something, yeah. But it wasn't like he was channeling some sort of teaching to me. No, he wasn't channeling any teaching to me. Like, I have to remember what he said. No, I mean, do you remember what conversation you had with your friend, you know, a couple of year ago or two? No, you don't remember exactly what it was, but you remember, oh yeah, it was pleasant. We had a pleasant conversation. I don't remember exactly about what. So it was kind of like that. I didn't feel any pressure to remember what he said. It was, you know, it was just like, well, kind of a low-key conversation. And maybe we talked about the weather. Or maybe the Giants, or San Francisco Giants or something. Maybe we talked about Tim Lincecum. Maybe he said, hey, you know, how's Timmy doing? And I said, well, you know, he's still, you know, struggling with a little bit of control and velocity and stuff. But, you know, we'll see. It could have been something like that. The idea was, he's just a friend. He's a friend. He's not here to, we got the teaching, okay, that was, so the Course of Miracles came first. We got familiar with his belief system, and then he came back and said, okay, I'm back now, you know, I'm here to relate with you as a friend, and that's it. That's nothing more than that. And so we had, how many years, 60, from 65, 75, 85, 95, 105, 15, that's 50 years. Is that possible? Yeah, October 21st, 1965 is when he first contacted Helen Schuckman. That's 50 years, and then April 29th is 50 years and a half, 50 and a half years, something like that. November, December, October, November. It was October 21st. October, okay. October, November, December, January, February, March, April. That's 6 months. So basically 6 months and 8 days, kind of 50 years, 6 months and 8 days. We've had to get used to Jesus contacting this world and start sharing his belief system here. So we have Anandamayi Ma, 100 years since she was 20 to get used to her, and then Jesus Christ 50 years and 6 months and 8 days to get used to his super grace. So that's 150 years right there of getting used to super grace. Right? And so we've had a lot of time, folks, to get used to this. A lot of time. That's plenty of time for those who really want to get used to it. And all we have to realize is this is super grace. It's not grace, it's super grace. Different story. So don't try to apply grace to super grace and think you can understand it in that way. Grace oftentimes is mere positivism, materialistic positivism. Oh, God really graced me, got me this car, that kind of thing. Super grace is different. Super grace graces us with the capacity of inquiry and success on that path, and frees our life up so that we can pursue this path. I got some new socks. I should have worn them. I'm going to wear those. They're very colorful socks. I saw somebody working out in these very colorful socks. I saw a couple guys. Now, I saw somebody at a store with these very colorful socks. Hello, kitty. Hi. Kitty, kitty, kitty. Yeah. A beautiful cat just walked by there. Triggered the light, and the light suddenly went on. Wow. Very interesting. Maybe that's super grace showing up. Yeah, these very colorful socks. I got to get some of those. And so I found some on sale, and I'm interested in wearing them. It's a great summer statement, colorful statement. So we should treasure our freedom in the United States to really do this inquiry in any which way we want to, without anybody bullying us too much. We still have this wonderful free country to some extent. But it's been sabotaged and undermined to an extreme extent. And it may be turned over to the communists very soon, actually. In some way. In some way. I'm sure there's a plan for this. Maybe like suddenly we need to pay the debt back or something, and now everybody then has to do their part in doing so. Therefore, we have to control your life to make sure your productivity is enough to be able to generate enough to pay back the debt that China, we have, debt we have with China, and we can't have people just taking it easy and doing what they want to do and spending a lifetime of inquiry. That's like complete. That doesn't pay back the debt at all. Can you see how this goes? I mean, I've not produced anything in my life other than encouragement to people to do inquiry. That's it. But as far as paying back the debt, that doesn't help at all, does it? They want everybody to produce things, material things and services in terms of the marketable stuff that can help start paying back the debt. Very, very clever situation. So we're now just about in the eye of the storm that's coming. July 24th is, and everything is happening. Suddenly, I get this inspiration, Dzogchen Tsempa for president, an alternative focus for us. Say we're supporting a third party candidate and their ideology, and we're just all in on that. See, it gives us a great focus to avoid a lot of pressure that's going to be put on people. People say, well, you need to support this cause, this cause, this cause. So, well, I'm supporting the cause of Dzogchen Tsempa for president. And he has an entire platform of spiritual practice. And he says that his our platform is spiritual practice is what we need to do to heal the spiritual ecology, the spiritual ecosystem of the planet. It's severely sick. And so Dzogchen Tsempa will help us As president, he will help us heal the spiritual ecosystem of the planet. That's what's really the biggest issue of any. It's way greener than anybody else. So we're like the greenest of all green parties in the world, for sure, right now, we are. So you can have the moral high ground. See, it's very important to have the moral high ground right now. And so Tsongkhapa for president is the moral high ground. So I encourage everyone to like this Facebook page so you start getting updates and support it with your art, your poetry, your art, your music. And, you know, I can link to it if you have something on YouTube or something you post that I feel is part of the camp, you know, right for the campaign. I mean, I'm the campaign manager. So I'll put it up there if it's in the right spirit. And there'll be linked to it and people will be able to see it. So it's a collaborative venture. If you have some way to contribute to the campaign, Tsongkhapa for president, which is the highest moral ground there is on the planet. And so people then cannot pull you down because you say, what do you mean? You don't have the moral high ground. I do. Who are you to bully me into a lower moral ground? That's ridiculous. Tsongkhapa for president. So that came. And then today I realized, whoa, wait a minute. He needs a vice president, doesn't he? So who's Tsongkhapa's vice president? That's an interesting question. And that was put to me today. And what are these little bugs all over the place? I said, yeah, let's find Tsongkhapa's vice president. Who's that going to be? Very interesting question. Don't know yet, but we should find out soon. So the ticket is complete, the complete ticket, right? So we have that to look forward to, that announcement to look forward to, and life goes on. So Southwest had this, you know, total, you know, terrible computer glitch, and then of course all their redundant backup systems, well, they all failed too. You know, yeah, right. This is a company who relies on computer systems for their business to an extreme extent, Southwest Airlines. In no way, shape, or form can they have this sort of computer meltdown. That's why they have all these redundant systems in place, and every one of them failed. Do you believe that? Yeah, right. It's called hacking. It's called hacking. They won't admit to that. I mean, any company is hacked, they won't admit to it unless they're put under a lot of pressure. Finally, they, you know, maybe months later, whatever, they'll admit that we've been hacked or something. We were hacked. But they always say it's a computer glitch. Really? Well. And of course, all the flyers, they'll forgive the others. Oh yeah, computer glitch happens all the time. Really? Well, what other computer glitches can happen? I think everybody now is so afraid to recognize what's going on that no matter what happens, they'll just say, oh, it's a computer glitch. Oh yeah, it's a big glitch. There's another one. Well, that glitch caused that glitch. You know, it's just glitches. Yeah, just glitches. No worries here. And these people want to turn their issue of free will over to a dictator in a central planning. They don't want to be bothered with it because it takes time, doesn't it? They don't want that. They're in too much of a rush to get rich and get all the material stuff they want so they can be happy. And so they don't want to be bothered with free will, so they want to get rid of it. It bothers me. So if everybody else doesn't talk about it, that'll help me out a lot. So they've basically gotten rid of this kind of talk most places in the world already. But those crazy Americans, you know, we still want to talk about free will and try to figure out what Jesus was talking about and what, you know, maybe this guru was talking about, what this Lama or Rinpoche or Tulku or Kenpo was talking about. And, yeah, and we don't particularly want anybody to be able to stop us, you know, so America's a stupid America. They cling under theirs, guns and Bibles, man. That got to stop that. That's what the POTUS said in 2008, right? Because, man, these, you know, clinging to their guns and Bibles. Wow, what a bunch of hillbillies. You know, we're way past that. We're ready for a central planning here. And get rid of this silly notion of free will, you know. Come on, have your vacations in Hawaii and be happy. Yeah, but, you know, I'm not so happy because I've been back to this world 33 times. And I'm sick and tired of it. And I want to know how to get free of this. And nobody has any answer here. If nobody knows how to get free of it, I'm not going to be a very happy camper. I'll tell you that. So, I place extreme value on those who know how to get free of the cycles of rebirth. I place ultimate value upon them. These are the Dharma kings. This is the super grace. Super grace knows how to get free of existence. And you don't get free of existence by saying it's real and then leaving it. You get free of existence by saying it's unreal, it's a dream, it's never existed really at all. It's like this pit that we think we're in. We have plausible inferences from contrasting labels that we're in some deep, dark pit. The fact of the matter is we're not in any pit at all. That's the answer to it. You don't fix failure. You don't get out of the pit. You realize you're never there. So there are these Dharma kings, super grace, they know this fact. We've never been in existence. There's, as Rano says, we've never been born. There's never been any world. None of this has ever taken place at all, the way that we believe at all. As a fact. So he knows this. Dharma kings know this. This is super grace. So we really, 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 my whole life has been geared to protect and preserve and extend this super grace. Because this is the only way any of us are going to get free of this hideous cycles of dream cycles of birth and death, rebirth, death, rebirth, death, rebirth, death, rebirth, death, suffer, 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 insecurity, fear, insecurity, threat, vulnerability, sickness, you know, more instability, more vulnerability, more fear of deprivation, hostility, conflict, personality troubles, mental troubles, troubles of every certain type, on and on and on and on and on, like an entire ocean, and you feel that you're a little fish in this infinite ocean, you got no choice but to swim in this misery forever. Well, guess what? The Dharma kings know how to get us out of this silly notion, and that is that we were never a fish in an ocean at all. What's this? A little bug. Is this a ladybug? What kind of bug is this? I don't know, maybe not. Or maybe it is. Looks like it is. Yeah, it's a little ladybug. Has come. This ladybug came last night. And landed on me and then flew. And now it's just sitting right here. There's different bugs. All sorts of bugs showing up. Along with ants. And this ladybug's just sitting right here. Just hanging out with me now. Very interesting, isn't it? Ladybug's a spiritual symbol for super grace, actually. So super grace is just here to hang out with us as friends. They're not here to walk on water, actually. They don't need to do it. They're just here as friends, that's all. So we'll just sit on the so-called sidelines of existence, but we realize that existence doesn't exist at all. So how could there be a sideline to existence? That's just a mental construct, concept, a delusional concept. This ladybug with orange wings. Interesting, huh? Symbolizing what? Super grace, Sri Sri Anandamaya Ma, maybe. Who's going to be our vice president? Who's going to be Dzogchenpa's vice president? Any suggestions? It's not going to be that one or that one. Or come on, got to be a suitable VP. I don't think the POTUS could handle being a VP. What? VP of Dzogchenpa? Are you kidding me? I'm higher than that. Who's going to be the VP? VP speaks for Dzogchenpa when Dzogchenpa is can't appear here or there. But guess what? Dzogchenpa really can't appear at all to our eyes. The presence is present, but it's a formless presence. Non-defined, non-fixated presence. 360-degree presence. Not going in any direction. It's going in 360-degree directions simultaneously. Friend of mine had a race apparently yesterday. I'm not going to say who or what or anything, but a car race, drag race, and I think he raced a BMW M Series 4, 4M Series, which is faster than that car. And he won the race, and the BMW's engine blew the engine. He blew an engine somehow. And his car is nondescript. Everybody thinks they can beat him because it's a very low-key car. Everybody says, "What? I could easily beat your car." But nobody can beat him. It's hot rodded under the hood. Everything's hot rodded. And so it's kind of like the Dharma King, Super Grace. People say, "Ah, not much. I could beat you pretty easily." But no, he can't. No way. They'll blow your doors off. But they may seem very low key and nondescript to us, to most people. Very low key. They're just here as our friends. They're not here to raise some army to smite the wicked. They're not here to build hospitals and temples and raise, all this massive institution and structure and all this kind of stuff. They're just here to hang out with us as friends. That's all. This is what we've been promised, actually. Jesus invited me to his home in a dream. And I said, "Yeah." But I said, "What do we do there?" "Let's just hang out as friends. I just invited you as a friend of mine. That's all." I said, "Yeah, but Jesus, what about, No, just as a friend." So you invite him friend over your friends over your house. What do you invite him over there for? Do you have some like agenda they gotta, do or something? No, you just hang out as friends. Talk about what you're interested in. "Well, I'm interested in redemption and salvation, so we'll talk about that." He is too. What else is there to talk about? For me, that's it. So I wouldn't have a problem conversing with Jesus. So what else do we talk about? Forgiveness, redemption, freedom, continuity fear, how to evaporate it, how to practice in the right way. That's it. Talk about that. So they present themselves. Super Grace does, presents itself as, just very friendly and low key, non-assuming, peaceful, calm, humorous, joyous, blissful. Of course, people who don't want Je who say they want Jesus to come back, but they're too afraid because they think that he's here to judge the wicked and they think they're wicked, they won't believe it's Jesus because they say, no. I really want to meet Jesus, and I can't meet this one here because I'm not ready, so this can't be Jesus." In other words, the idea of missing Jesus is so intolerable to them that they refuse to realize they are missing him. So they'll say, "No, that's not Jesus. You're crazy, ridiculous. Jesus will only come back when I'm ready for him." Well, Jesus is coming back now. Remember, he said he's going to come back at the end of the age, whether you're ready or not. Because if you don't get his help now, you're going to criticize him later on. So, "Jesus, why didn't you help us during this hideous time of we're shifting into this, belief that the free will doesn't exist, and you didn't come to help me with that? That's horrible, Jesus." So Jesus has to come now, otherwise we think he'd abandon us. And yet many people, in a no-win condition situation, they'll say, "Hey, Jesus, you came back too soon. I wasn't ready for you, so I missed you. That's horrible." And Jesus said, "Well, it's better than not coming back and then feeling that I betrayed you, right? So I didn't betray you by coming back. You're just not ready. So you might be upset with me, but at least I didn't betray you. I did what exactly what I told you I'd do. I'd come back at the end of the age for those, you know, for the harvest. And if you're not ready, it's because you were lazy. Like those foolish virgins who didn't have oil in their lamps. I warned you about that, didn't I? And they say, yeah, you did, Jesus, that's true. And so they may be upset with him, but they're not going to feel betrayed by him. So, yeah, he's a tough, can't-win position. But certainly, you can forgive Jesus. You know, if you weren't ready, you say, well, it was my fault. Ultimately, it was my fault, not your fault. So I'm glad you did. You were a man of your word. You made a promise. You kept your promise. So I can trust you next time. When you say you're going to come back also to help again, I'll trust you and I'll prepare for that. So it sets up the next, you know, round of super grace by coming back now, even though many are not prepared, obviously. So I continued to work out and did a very intensive one today. Wow. Holy Spirit told me what to do. I did exactly what the Holy Spirit said. It worked out great. Nice mixture of people. Some yoga girls, some ordinary girls, some guys, ordinary guys, some tattooed guys, yoga guys. It's just a mix of everybody. Some Tai Chi guys and some older guys and young and some children. It's just a whole gamut working out. And I'm just plowing ahead, you know, just get it done. Don't worry what other people are doing, just get it done. I love what the Tai Chi guy was doing, walking backwards. I gave a thumbs up. I don't know if he saw me, but I said, wow, because I had this intuition. I need to start walking backwards, learn how to walk backwards. That's what he was doing. That was part of his exercise regime, was to walk backwards. I said, yeah, that's really cool. Because just last night I said, I got to start running backwards or walking backwards. This is very good exercise, super exercise, really great. So I was the first person I seen doing that. And he's a very different type of guy. Chinese guy, but you know, like a Tai Chi sort of spiritual type of guy. And somehow he had the wisdom knowing walking backwards is a very, 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 very powerful exercise. This little bug's still here. He says, I'm gonna leave. He says, I found a little home right here. We're just gonna hang out together. How are we doing on this video? 122, okay. So, you know, time is running out on us, that is for sure. So, I got to get focused and get stuff done, get prepared. Yeah, we'll be ready. One way or another, we're going to do what we can do. God's grace going before us. I don't know what's going to happen at all. Will the vice presidential candidate show up to complete the ticket with Zog Champa? Not Zong, Zog Champa. It's not Dog, D-O-G, it's D-Z-O-G. So it's different than Dog Champa. We're not following Dog. We're following Zog Champa, the great spaciousness, the great completion, the great natural completion, the great natural completion. Of the mind, and mind's true nature, the nature of mind, which isn't this nature we see in the world at all. This is just a plausible inference that mind isn't mind, that it's fixated, that it's been changed. It's not what it used to be. Belief in time. That's not the true nature of mind at all. What to do on the vacation? I don't know. But for me, it's sitting on the sidelines is what it's about. And doing that artfully and beautifully. It doesn't mean we need to sit in some mud fort or something, you know. It doesn't. We could be in a nice place and just sit in the sidelines. And then do your practicing, which keeps you centered in realizing, why am I sitting on the sidelines? That's all important, isn't it? Milarepa sat in a cave by Mount Kailash. You know, that's sitting on the sidelines, isn't it? They say the cave was very warm, very cozy. So this cave can be very nice. I mean, super cold climate, but they're nice and toasty in there with their butter lamps. Not bad. Sat on the sidelines up there. Tibetans have been sitting on the sidelines of the world for a long time. Actually, they're very expert at it. So the symbol I was gotten was this car. And what color was the car? It was red, beautiful red, like my shirt, like my hat. Red hats symbolize the red hats are going to help us realize infinity. The 300, we're free in 360 degree directions, all directions simultaneously. We're free. We're not just free in this direction. We're always free in all directions. We're always free in all directions. There's no way that one direction can predominate. We're completely free in all directions, always. This is the feeling that we of that let everything be the echo of silence. Let everything you perceive be the perceiving a beautiful echo of silence. This came to me last night. Echo of silence. Perceive the echo of silence. Everything we see is just a beautiful echo of silence. That's all it is. Since it's perception, we're still perceiving it. It's not the actual silence, really. We can't know it. So we say it's the echo, a very, very clear echo of silence. Silence echo. Silence goes silent. Ooh, and we get this bounce echo. Ooh, very clear to us. But it's an echo, like it bounces. It's bouncing, but very beautiful and clear echo of silence. This is what we can perceive this. We perceive that we do not need to perceive. That the percep we perceive the perception is a choice, not a need. I already perceive that perception is a choice, not a need. That's the official motto of or the practice of our platform, Dzogchenpa for President's platform. I already perceive that perception is a choice, not a need. The motto is one insight settles it all. And our guiding principle is a super grace. We're the super grace party, the Dzogchenpa for President's super grace party. The super grace party. There you go. That's the party name. Super grace party. Our candidate is Dzogchenpa. Our motto is one insight settles it all. Our platform is to practice saying, I already perceive that perception is a choice, not a need. Very simple. So let us find who the vice president is. This should be interesting. Maybe it's this ladybug. Yeah. So this great response to my comment on Ananda Maima Facebook page indicates there's a lot of people who feel that she's close, she's coming back. They could feel it, that she's working on their lives profoundly, and there's a thirst for that. There's a tremendous sense of thirst, like wow. People feel it. They're feeling it. They're feeling it, and they should feel it. Most people in the world, they don't have the freedoms that the United States has experienced. So they don't really know how much they've lost, how unfree their thinking and minds are. They're not really free to consider true inquiry about free will that very much, and have free will extend to their bodies and their culture and their families and their lives and everything, politics, everything. But so they don't really realize the kind of threat we're under. But if you're an American, really know what freedom really feels like, then you're aware that you're losing it, you know, right? You become aware of its erosion. It's severe erosion. Just like if like you live in a place where there's no crime at all, when there starts being a bunch of crime coming in, you start saying, "Whoa, what's going on here?" Whereas if you live in a ghetto where all there is crime, what's a little bit more crime? You don't hardly notice it. Oh yeah, it's just crime everywhere. I feel terrible. What can I do? So when you get the encroachment on our freedoms and on the Constitution, what has happened? You're very aware of it and alarmed by it. Where I think the rest of the world just says, you know, everything's fine in the world, no big deal. Well, it is a big deal. It's a very big deal. Because once the US falls, the whole world's going to fall into dictatorship. And they will dictate to you exactly what your freedom consists of. And you are not supposed to have any mind to consider this at all. You're like a robot. You're just programmed. This is your programming. You'll be a robot, human robot. This is your programming. I had this dream last night where it started raining right now. I mean, the rain started coming down. And it rained so hard that there were floodwaters everywhere. And right here where I live, our yard was flooded. Everything was so flooded, and the floodwaters were so deep it covered all our cars. All our cars were covered by this floodwater. And I was just like, oh my God, all our cars are gonna be ruined. It's horrible. And then I asked somebody who's like knowledgeable about this, and he said, no, they're sealed up. They're sealed up, don't worry. And he said, well, if they got a good seal, they'll be okay. When the waters recede, they'll be okay. Of course, if they're not sealed well, then they're going to be ruined. So he pointed out, he said, this one, you see, it's got a good seal here, and the doors and every windows are shut. So the water's not going to get in. It's not going to get in. And I said, wow, okay, but it was very intense, the flood that's coming. Muddy water. I mean, it was dirty water. It wasn't real clean and clear at all. So the world's about to be flooded by confusion that's not, not clear. Water is, of course, turbulent as it's flooding. So this confused turbulence is about to flood the world. The world's about to be flooded, and we're going to be inundated with it. We're going to be inundated by it. But what this person said, I asked, is he said that those who are sealed up in wisdom will emerge from this, and they'll be okay. But those who are foolish, not going to be so okay. Their vehicle's not so okay. So here come the floodwaters of confused turbulence, turbulent confusion. In this dream, it just rain and rain and rain like you can't believe. And the whole landscape was nothing but water, flood water. I was standing up above it on some concrete, solid concrete area. So it didn't touch me. But I was looking down at it and said, wow, all those cars are just getting, are inundated. Severe inundation is coming of turbulent confusion. So sit on the sideline and pay attention to electing Dzogchen Tsempa for president. Pay attention to his candidacy, to Dzogchen Tsempa's candidacy. We use the traditional nominative, his candidacy. We don't use it that much, but pay attention to the candidacy of Dzogchen Tsempa, which is just a nominative word. It doesn't indicate male or female gender. But when we do use a nominative pronoun, we're just going to use the he. We're not going to get into this stupid he-she debate. That is so stupid. It wasted 50 years, 60 years of our time, actually. It's formless. Reality is formless, okay? There's no gender. But we want to emphasize that materialistic positivism is the devil. I mean, this is what pulls us down. And so we certainly have to err on the side of caution by so using the male, when we use a nominative, using just the he or his or something, when occasionally we do that, that's erring on the side of caution. That's just the right move to make. That's all. It's pragmatic, right move to make. As I said, women are in this more materialistically focused because they need to be because of their children. So they think they can have it both ways, a lot of that both ways. And you can't have it both ways. So it's not good to imply you can have it both ways. So the wisdom throughout history is used the male, a nominative pronoun, he, for God or something. But there's no he, God. There's just the freedom God. So we're just going to say, if people bring that up, we just say, look, this is all about electing Dzogchen Tsempa president, and Dzogchen Tsempa is formless. So practice sitting on that. We're sitting on the sidelines. We got to practice why we're sitting on the sidelines and this ridiculous circus that's been going on in the world about gender pronouns and stuff is just not going to be addressed here at all. It's very, very much an egoic distraction. What we need to do is practice. That's it. practice, practice, practice. Alektazag Jempa, present. Now, if you look at Padmasambhava, you're not saying that a man or a woman. You're saying, whoa. Wow. You're saying, wow. Not whoa, but wow. You're saying, wow. I don't think this is anybody at all. I think this is just a leaf that's fluttering in front of this brilliant, luminous mind. This is just a luminous mind. This isn't a person. So we're not getting into any activism at all except electing Zogchenpa president. That's it. How do we do that? He's got to be our president. So we got a choice. You know what? We can say, you know what? He's our president. He's going to be our president. Come January, 27th, 2017, Zogchenpa is going to be our president. Plain and simple. I don't care what the others elect. It's all bogus anyway. All right? Bought and paid for in a lot of ways. Whatever happens with that, let them have their little shadow play. We're going to elect Zogchenpa president. Plain and simple. He's going to be, Zogchenpa is going to be president. Someone had these videos of whales in the Pacific Ocean, right near the beach, and they said, I got these video of whales breaching and, you know, jumping out. And said, here, let me show it to you. And so they kept trying to find the video, and they couldn't find the whale jumping up at all. It was amazing, but they said, no, it's on there somewhere. Well, what was this, a symbol of Super Gray suddenly breaching, jumping up out of the ocean, right? Yeah. Could be that, or... They also said that it comes up and swallowing all the fish. They hurt all the fish and then they swallow them down. That's why all the birds are there. You can tell where the whales are because all the birds, all the bait fish are there. Anchovies, mackerel, whatever, little bait fish that the whales just, you know, great blue group of whales scoop them up and filter them out, baleen, some sort of filter they have with the water streams through and the fish stay. Very clever net they have. Maybe it signifies what's coming in the world about all of us being rounded up and, you know, exterminated by this great whale force. But for somehow she could not get any picture of the whale showing up on the video for me, and she was very frustrated. She kept doing over and over and over and over and over. Try this one. Never did it show any whale jumping up. She was like, wow, I'm going to have to edit this, she said. This is really weird. Well, maybe it was showing me that for you, no whale's going to show up and swallow you. That could be that. Try as they might, the New World Orderists and the Yoga Girls and all the, you know, ones who are involved with that, they're not going to swallow us because the Guru's blocking it. Guru won't let it happen. So the bottom line is, put your faith in the Guru. I don't have any other instructions. Put your faith in the Guru. This is what I was told today. And then I saw another sign that they're running to us right now. They're not jogging, they're running. So in other words, they're running to meet us right now. Fast, really fast. Their pace has picked up significantly. And this is what I'm experiencing, I can feel it. They're really, really going fast right now to meet us. So as far as like, well, how do we do this? What do we do? How do we sit in this islands? Where do we go? This and that, that. No, just trust in the Guru. They have a plan, and their plan will work. And so we just need to relax, have confidence in the Gurus, just be secure that we're choosing to sit on the sidelines and to investigate our free will. We're going to continue to inquire into our free will in a powerful way. Okay? And so to do this, we will not be in harm's way. Okay, well, we will not be rounded up. We will not be in harm's way. We will sit on the safely on the sidelines, calmly out of the way of all this turmoil, and we will continue with our sadhana of inquiry having confidence that the answers are there, and I can tell you the answers are there. 100% for sure. The answers, I've heard them, I've seen them, I've considered them, I've seen what they lead to, I've experienced it. It's all there for us, all of it's there for us. And we most certainly will get to it, and then we'll realize, yeah. There never was an I in existence, bound by time, space, process, and form at all. This is all just completely made up. Everything's we've always been free. We never lost our freedom. And on with these realizations that everything has always been perfect. Nothing needs to be fixed at all. That's the ultimate. And everything's just a beautiful echo of silence. Beautiful echo of silence. And we can perceive this. We can perceive that perception's a choice, not a need. And that we don't need to perceive at all. We can perceive this. Don't need to. I can choose to, but I don't need to. So trust, the motto, trust in the gurus, trust in the gurus. They will show up. This is what they're saying. They will show up in some way. Super grace is going to show up. And it's showing up in my life. Boom, 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 boom. I keep working out. So you know what? I can run up a hill right now. I told them I'll run up any mountain. I give a big harangue to the Dharma Kings today. Telling them, I'm adamant that you show up now. Absolutely adamant. And I say to you, you come down a mountain, I'll run up that mountain. And I'll get to the top. Believe me, I'll do it fast, too. I can run up any mountain right now. I will run up a mountain. I won't walk. I will run up a mountain to greet you. Because I've been working out. My legs, I'm getting them so strong, to basically run up a mountain. When I walk, I feel like I'm walking on springs or something. It's like, wow, spring-loaded. It's a good feeling, actually. You feel like a pogo stick. So instead of begging the gurus to show up, why don't we just say, the gurus have already showed up. They've already showed up. In practice like this, the gurus have already showed up. Wow. See, so our practice is the already practice, which leads to the wow. Wow. There's no wiggle room. Not, I hope they show up. I'm praying that they show up. No. Wow. I'm experiencing that they've already showed up. They've literally already showed up, and I'm experiencing them. It's already happened. It's already happened. The gurus have already showed up. It's already happened. The gurus have already showed up. Shown up. Practice like this. It's already happened. The gurus have already shown up. How much free space do I have here? A little bit. So it's already happened. The gurus have already shown up. Simple, simple practice. This is the already practice, which is the key to our success. Practice as if it's already happened. God has already blessed me. God's super grace has already shown up. I'm already experiencing super grace. The gurus have already shown up. Take all wiggle room and doubts out of your mind. It's already happened. So where are the doubts? No doubts. The super grace has already shown up. Guru's already shown up. They're already here. I'm already aware of them. Already interacting with them. Everything is already happening. Everything is already happening. And just breathe with that. Everything's already happening. Just relax with that. Now you might shake a little bit. Everything's already happening. The work that I did today, wow, that got not only my legs but my core. I really had to put effort into it. Determination, great determination and effort. Really determined, super determined. So right down to the wire here, if you're watching this on the 23rd, most likely, let's find our candidate. When will they show up? Let's pray for that. Ask for that. Looks like they've already shown up. They've already shown up. The vice president, our vice presidential candidate, has already shown up. The one who's going to be our vice president, Sogchenpa, is already going to be our president. We've already elected him president. Maybe we'll put him in office right away. I don't know. Or maybe we'll wait till 2017. But we'll have a campaign, and then we'll say he's our president. That's it. President of our country, the country that we live in, Sogchenpa is the president. And we allow him to suggest to us what practices we can use to be effective, recognize our inquiry, to have a successful inquiry. So Sogchenpa. President Sogchenpa. And VP, the little ladybug's still here. I think he's going to just sleep here. Right? Yeah. Let me see. Let me look at it. I look at it more carefully. It's not exactly a ladybug. It looks very much like it. It's a little bigger than a ladybug. Okay, so that's why I was able to look at it. Hello. Yeah, it's not quite a ladybug. Same kind of configuration. Coloration's a little more faded, a little more muted. But it's on this red cover that I have. So understated, it's an understated ladybug. Understated. Super Grace being very understated. Okay, so how we do? We did pretty well, didn't we? 140 something, 146. That's enough. That's enough. And wow. Just wow it. You know, wow your life right now. I know people are telling me fellow Sogchenpanites are telling me that all sorts of great breakthroughs are happening now. It's true. Just be aware of your life and pray for it, and you'll find it's going to come like that. Very much so. I was even hitting the high notes on fun, and I Get Around and Help Me Run, all the Beach Boys songs. I was hitting them. I've hit them the last couple of days. Today I hit them repeatedly. Wow. It's like, wow. It's still shifting all around. I'm still ragging at that. But at least to be able to hit the highest Brian Wilson notes is pretty something. It's really something. At my age, are you kidding me? I could really hit him when I was young. I could have sung like Brian Wilson, but I couldn't quite sing with him because that was his natural voice. It wasn't his falsetto. That was his natural voice. It's really rare to hear someone sing like that. Quite rare. And it gave the Beach Boys their signature sound, really. For just a natural male falsetto like that, his voice is not, it's pitched in just that way. So it had this tonal quality to it. The intonations of it and everything was just different than anybody else. And so if you just go falsetto, it doesn't sound the same. It doesn't sound as good, as a matter of fact. Signature sound of the Beach Boys. Wow. Still, for me, the most pleasant music around. Nothing is really unseated at all, actually. As some of the gas station came in, I was there, and they came in and they got out of their car and they're all crippled. They're just all hardly able to move. This man, this elderly man, like my age. I said, whoa. And then he got back in his car and he turns it on, and what's on the CD? He's playing Van Halen. Van Halen was on it, and I felt like saying, "Ah, wow, you know, yeah." But Yeah, I got Van Halen, man, Steady Eddie. But then I said, wait a minute. I got the Beach Boys on. Beach Boys are way better than Van Halen, as far as the sound. Really, I'd much prefer listen to the Beach Boys than Van Halen. But I just thought you got to be progressive, so you got to keep making progress. But wait a minute, have we been progressing musically? I don't think so, because isn't it about just the aesthetics? Is it about technique and Eddie's technique, or is it about just the overall ambience of it? How does it really sound? And the Beach Boys' overall ambience of it is just—it's so extraordinary, actually. It's got such a different feel to it, doesn't it? That the music that came after it, never recaptured that, or really got the feel is just not as good, actually. My opinion, the way I feel. A little more frantic, a little more impatient. The Beach Boys have this lovely pacing to the music. It's lively but relaxed. It's this lively, relaxed, 360-degree ambient sort of feeling. And yeah, it just seems to sparkle in all directions, kind of. But it's still relaxed and calm. Even when they're singing about cars, it still feels that they're just. They're calm, relaxed, confident. They're not tight and nervous and hurrying and scurrying and grasping and struggling and stuff like that. It doesn't feel that way. It's just this wonderful, relaxed ambience. Or just, we got the time to go out and catch waves, sit in the beach. We've been having fun all summer long. Yeah, we're just having fun this summer. Just having fun all summer long. Who does that now? Most people, they're constantly organize their activity and their hours. Do this. The kids, summer camp, this thing, soccer, this soccer. I mean, back then, we just had fun all summer long. We just walk around barefoot eating popsicles, basically, and just meeting up with other friends eating popsicles and hanging out and laughing and jumping rope and playing in fountains and doing, going swimming, and we just hang out. We just hung out and had fun playing baseball, barbecues. We didn't. We not. I never thought of doing anything in the summertime. In fact, when they did, I said, "What are you talking about? It's my summer. I just want to have fun. Go to the beach. Just hang out at the beach all day. Not think about school or not think about organization or, what's high school am I getting into? What next? What's my next school? Strategizing. We just. I we. I forgot totally about school." Totally forgot about school and just sat around listening to the Beach Boys and the beach transistor radio. Just had fun. Go collect shells on the beach. Just be creative. Forget about materialism and making things and being organized and efficient. Just forget about it all. Summer was for just having fun. So we've been having fun all summer long. Won't be long now till summer's gone. Do, 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 do. So they had that song, beautiful song. T-shirts, cutoffs, and a pair of thongs. That's what we wore. We wore blue jean cutoffs, T-shirts, and a pair of sandals called rubber, sorries, thongs. Pair of sandals. That's what we wore here in California. T-shirt, cutoffs, and sandals. And just wandered around all summer long in that outfit. Eating, go to the store, eat the potato chips, salty potato chips. Maybe go to a movie occasionally. Not so often. Actually, we'd rather be outside. Play catch, sit around, play guitar, or play music, and get up when we felt like getting up, stay up late, eat caramelized popcorn, lots of orange juice in the morning, sit out in the sun, get a tan, laugh, listen to the radio, share our experiences. And just be in this mood, this mellow mood of just, there's nothing I need to do, nowhere I need to go. The endless summer. And just enjoy just feeling the world, the vibe of everything. Just feel it. And just say, yeah, but we're not, we're in it, but not of it. The world didn't create us. This is our own projection. We're just experiencing our own mental projection. That's all. But we're the mind itself. So I still remember that. That's how I grew up. That's how I felt that we have a right not to spend all our time in school. And I want to spend my time in self-inquiry and stay in touch with spirit and with mind, the true nature of mind. But this world has gone a long ways from that, hasn't it? Boy, trips, 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 trips. Structure, 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 structure. Get ready, you know, you got to, you know, especially those who are fast-tracked, you know, for success. My God, they're under relentless pressure from their parents, from their peers, from their teachers, from everybody. You can't waste a day. What are you doing? What are you doing? What are you doing over there? Hey, you know, you need to be soon, you know, thinking about your future, doing something better than that. Come on, what are you doing? What are you doing? What are you doing? I just sitting under a tree in some dichondra. As a matter of fact, I had a dream last night where I was lying on the lawn, and I thought, gee, the lawn maybe is not so green anymore. And you know what? I suddenly looked at it, and it was this velvety, beautiful velvety, the whole thing with dichondra, this beautiful dichondra, which is like this clover-like leaf, beautiful, soft, luscious. The whole thing was grown in tightly with beautiful dichondra. We used to have dichondra lawn here. And it's like, what? Are you kidding me? That's awesome. Dichondra once made a comeback here for a couple years. I tried to water it and keep it alive, but for some reason I couldn't. It the atmosphere here, it can't grow a dichondra anymore. You don't see anymore. We used to have this beautiful dichondra lawns. Oh my gosh, those are beautiful. And so in the dream last night, I was lying on this lawn that the dichondra had come back. And I associate that with childhood. And how you just sit in shorts in the dichondra and wiggle your toes and eat your Cracker Jacks. And look at the sky and listen to the sounds. Notice everything. And feel like, you know, you're not even in a world at all. It's just you're in this experiencing. You're just experiencing. So, amazing stuff that's going on right now. And I know there are many of you out there in the world that are, this is all happening for you too. We're all experiencing this together here. I don't want to eat anything. I want to have a good weight tomorrow. Got to. Man, it's, for me it's so difficult to keep my weight down. Just brutal. I'm on a fruit diet now, so I just eat fruit mostly. I think it's avocado fruit. I don't know, tomato is, right? Maybe avocado's not because it doesn't have the seeds like that, but it's got one seed. Maybe we'll call it a fruit. But I have strawberries today, blueberries, cherry juice, avocado, and then chocolate protein powder and drink. Oh, papaya. Yeah, I made a whole papaya, chocolate papaya smoothie. So I had that, papaya, strawberries, blueberries, avocado, chocolate protein drink. Pretty nice day, right, of food. Sounds like something a kid would enjoy. Papaya chocolate smoothie. Yeah, on a hot summer's day, yeah, why not? Sounds great. That cherry juice, yummy. Great stuff. Strawberries, yuck yeah, heck yeah. So, very interesting here. All right. So continue to wow what happens to you. Wow it. Because it's very intense. We're in a very intense time. Just make sure you stay calm. Don't waste your energy talking to people about bad stuff, what's happening in the world. Try to appear, yeah, I made a mistake today, wasted some energy. Don't waste your energy. Be quiet. Be humble. Don't say too much. Just hello, thank you. Just stay under the radar at this point. Be very unassuming. Stay under the radar. Okay, very great. That's it for this one.